A soccer field-sized patch of forest in frigid Alaska has about 40 different species of trees, shrubs, and herbs, compared with about 70 in temperate England and 300 in the Amazonian rainforest. These biodiversity differences hold true for entire countries, too. England has 1,500 plant species, while tropical Guyana has 6 times that many. This super diversity of tropical rainforests is only equaled in one other type of ecosystem on Earth: scrubby, fire-prone shrublands that grow in Western Australia and Southern Africa. These shrublands may not look as majestic as tropical rainforests, but in a given area, they're home to similarly stupendous numbers of species. Which doesn't necessarily mean that the rainforests and shrublands are easy places for plants to live. In fact, both ecosystems owe their enormous diversity in part to the fact that their soils have critically low supplies of nitrogen and especially phosphorus, nutrients plants need in order to grow. The plant world's leading biodiversity hotspots are, quite literally, dirt poor. Logically, it seems like richer soils should support more species, but in nature, as in human society, plenty of resources doesn't necessarily translate into everyone gets plenty. In meadows, forests, and wetlands around the world, we consistently find more or bigger plants but fewer species where soil nutrients are highest. The fastest spreading species soak up most of the extra nutrients, which lets them keep growing super fast, which lets their roots suck up so much water and their leaves snatch up so much sunlight that other slower species actually get less of those resources than otherwise. So in rich soils, slower species die out, while the fast growers win big. On the other hand, poor soils don't provide enough nutrient capital for fast-growing plants to build their massive infrastructures and take all the resources. So poor soils inhibit the greedy and allow everyone else to scrabble by. We see this pattern in human society too. In any given industry, there's a far greater number of mostly small businesses in poor countries, while fewer bigger companies dominate in rich countries. But crummy soil isn't the only thing that helps super high diversity blossom. For example, beaches, mountaintops, and other places frequently ravaged by harsh weather or catastrophic events have poor soils and few plant species. The other major prerequisite for hyperdiversity is time. On most of the planet, glaciers regularly bulldoze away ecosystems and grind up mineral-rich rock, creating new soil perfect for growth, but not diversity. However, our high-diversity rainforests and shrublands have spent millions of years beyond the reach of the ice sheets, leaving their residents plenty of undisturbed time to evolve a wide variety of ingenious strategies for surviving nutrient poverty. Strategies that have allowed for the development of tall, diverse rainforests in wet, poor soils, and scrubby, diverse shrublands in dry, poor soils. The human landscape also seems to follow a similar pattern, with the highest cultural and linguistic diversity as well as the greatest number of businesses in climatically stable places where humans have been the longest and where economic resources are scarce. So in some ways, the poorest places on Earth are actually also the richest. This episode of Minute Earth is supported by the Kwangin Foundation at the University of Western Australia, which promotes the conservation of Australia's amazing biodiversity. To learn more about the ecology of the hyperdiverse Kwangin ecosystem, check out the book Plant Life on the Sand Plains in Southwest Australia, or visit the Kwangin Foundation online. Thanks so much to the Kwangin Foundation, and the Kwangin, for making this Minute Earth video possible.